What's the vision for the future?
Well, we expected it much from this meeting. We moved on and we started with groundwater, but now we are gathering navigation.
Right.
Several different fields. And I like the way the work has emerged in
But that's interesting. You are strong on your platform, as you can understand from IIM in the world. What about you, the groundwater? What is your research?
Actually, my supervisor, Dr. Rangan, he has been working in a very bad way. He was going to become the groundwater. But I wanted to come in Gujarat. So I ended up meeting Dr. Kurian, and he offered me a job. So, because I preferred being an academic more than in a banking kind of setting, I kind of settled down in Australia. But in my head, I continue to have the least traditional field work. I really go in India and students with people. So, 1984, I was working in a village in Gujarat with a few students. This was kind of not a very well developed village. But the students had to kind of build farm budgets. So they would go every day in the morning. We were staying, all three of us were staying in one farm. And the students would go and start. They would be interviewing farmers about their farm economics. In the evening, they would come back with a questionnaire and they would return them to me. And I would look at the questionnaire. And day after day after day, I ended up finding that the students' farm budgets, they had huge bills on water. I didn't know anything about water, but I was intrigued by the fact that if the total production was X, the water bill was 0.3X. So a large part of the output was actually just paying for the purchase of water. Then I found that the entire village economy, the agriculture, was being irrigated by 16 wells, boreholes. All the boreholes had diesel engines, and some had electric engines. And the farmers were saving water in 16 to 17 rupees an hour. When their actual incremental cost of producing water for 1 hour was about 3 rupees. So I, as an economist, I saw the monopoly playing out and I thought it was a good case for teaching students. So I kept on encouraging students and we kept on able to get that. And then we finished the field work and we came back. There was another similar group which is coming from Meerut. And there also they had found these water markets working. And the students said that their farmers, their owners were selling water for 5 rupees. And the buyers of water was the untouchables and those vegetable goods. They were very happy with the way these water markets were working. So I was intrigued as an economist. Why is it that in Panchmahal it was selling at 16 rupees and in Meerut it was water was selling at 5 rupees? So we started, kind of started working on why water markets in different areas were working. At that time, I wasn't even sure that I understood groundwater from surface water. And I was just interested in this economic institution. So, taking help from this institution of fieldwork at Denmark, I then over the next 2 years had students get me data from different parts of India. Then I found that the water selling was very expensive. And actually, a significant proportion of Indian agriculture was actually dependent on purchased groundwater. So I just wrote up a short article as a teaching article and then shared it with some other researchers, Dr. Chambers, and etc. They brought home to me that what I was talking about is something very important, that irrigation was important to India and that agriculture was an important part of the economy and that this is something that was helping very poor people. So then I published that article and then kind of it got me some funding in, to do more work on that. The Food Foundation gave me a small grant. So I actually never had any intention of working on water, legal or groundwater, but I was interested more in these institutions and that would be working with the markets. But then as you keep working more and more on it, then began touching the hydrologists, hydrogeologists, and understanding the level of water science. But all of their water science was kind of learning from friends and other countries. And 15 years later, I got invited to the DV's institutions program, all based on this work on groundwater models. And then by then I had, lurched full scale into the world of water.
Right.
And I started working.
What's the interest in responsibility is that, as you mentioned, right from the beginning, it's the sort of informal market, not the organized market, not the structured market, but the informal market is the providing service in water at a price. So in a sense, there's no subsidy there. And this is a form of a solution, which may be suboptimal, some may argue, but maybe optimal in the situation. So are those lessons of the role of the informal market and the financial monies they bring in, it has to be captured enough by policy? Is policy willing to absorb this?
Much more so now than was the case, I think, in 1970s and 80s, almost all the discussion in the water was about water. I was interested in people who were using water in various different ways, creating value. I think today there is much greater recognition that it's not just about people, it's about water itself, it's not correct. It's the way people deploy water. I think that dimension is much bigger when it's today, but about the fact that if you want irrigation systems much better, you have to work on the irrigation departments as much as the system itself.
Right. And so what do you see as the future now that we have 30 million boreholes, maybe 250 cubic kilometers of water connection, groundwater connection?
I think things will get worse because it will get better.
Right.
I think that, as I've argued in my book, I think the problem is because we have an agriculture which is carrying much bigger load than it is designed. And this will continue for some time. So the ultimate solution is, I think, agriculture getting some of the problems, reducing the burden of agriculture, so it approaches the carrying capacity of the agriculture. This can only take place by moving people out of agriculture. So that's not going to happen anytime soon. It's going to be a problem here.
You may be a bit gung-ho about the Gujarat approach to both groundwater as well as to electricity, energy management. Are you very positive about this story? Is it something that touches
upon? No, I'm positive about the fact that Gujarat, at the level of the common as well as the level of people, is actually applying itself to this province with a certain amount of seriousness. Which I don't see happening in many of the states. In many of the states, I think political leaders and administrators bring a lot of good sense. And even when they're taking up new ideas, they're implementing it half-hearted. Whereas in Gujarat, I think when they take up and they've identified water as a major problem, which it is for Gujarat. And I think the last 20 years, we have gone about it with a method, with a level of seriousness that really is laudable. And that is more fruits.
Right.
I think that to the ground as well, I think that Gujarat is better off now in groundwater terms than it was between 17 years ago. I think that Gujarat agriculture is kind of booming, is the only state in the country. In agriculture, GDP growth rate of 9-10%, which is, I mean, great to grow. Agriculture is still growth rate of 5%. Actually, we are trying to grow at 2-2.5%.
Yes.
He has not been doing that. It's been an eyesore. The dam is ready, the main canal is ready, but the irrigation is